Trinity is a word that means tri-unity, or three in oneness. So it's the idea of three independent things coming together, working as one, or being one. So in this case, what it's saying is that God is three independent persons coming together as one. Now, the concept of the Trinity is taught throughout the entire Bible. We might think it's just a New Testament thing. We might think it's just something that came about once Jesus went back to heaven. But no, we can see teachings about the Holy Spirit, about the Trinity, throughout the entire Bible. In fact, it starts in the very first verse of the Bible. Right? Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created." Actually, it says, "In the beginning, Elohim created." Okay? Elohim is the plural of the Hebrew word El, which means God. Now, I'm no English expert, but if I'm using a plural word, that means more than one, right? So here in this verse, if it's referring to God in the plural, it's meaning that within that Godhead, there is plurality. There is more than one there. Okay, so when it says, in the beginning, Elohim created, it's saying, in the beginning, the Godhead, all of those who compose the Godhead, created. So it's teaching more than one. It's teaching the Trinity. Moving on in Genesis 1, verse 26, we have these words. Let us make man in our image after our likeness. Again, God is speaking, and he's using plural pronouns. Right? He could have said, I'm going to make God like me. But he said, let's make him in our image. Let us do this. Okay, again, a plurality. Talking about God being more than just one person. Therefore, the plural pronouns are necessary to be used. In Psalm 110, verse 1, King David is writing, and he says this, "The Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand." Now, you may have heard that verse before, and you think, but I didn't know it was in Psalms. That's right. Peter uses it in Acts. It's part of his sermon at Pentecost. And what he's saying there is, he's talking about God, Lord and Lord, as two persons. If you look at Matthew 22, Jesus understood David to be speaking of God as being two persons. If you look at the verse in Psalm 110:1, you'll find that when it says, my Lord, or the Lord says to my Lord, the first Lord is all capital letters. The second Lord is capital L, lowercase O-R-D. So it's referring to God the Father, Yahweh, and God the Son. So if we were to look at this, or when we look at this from our New Testament perspective, we would read the verse this way. God the Father said to God the Son, have a seat at my right hand. Okay? But even if we don't look at it that way, from the wording itself, we can see that David understood that God was more than just one person. Why else would he say, the Lord says to my Lord? He's talking about God in both of those situations. So he's referring to God being more than one person, a plurality of persons. Moving on in the Old Testament, Isaiah 63, verse 10. God states that his people have rebelled and have grieved his Holy Spirit. Alright, so when he phrases it that way, it suggests that the Holy Spirit is a separate person from God himself. He doesn't say that my people have rebelled and grieved me, but have grieved my Holy Spirit. Something separate, something distinct, something unto itself. Not only that, but when it says that he was grieved, it's giving human emotions, meaning the Holy Spirit is a person. It's not an it, it's not a force, it's not a thing. It has personality and is able to have emotions such as grief. So there it speaks to the separateness of the three, and that they are individuals, or that the Godhead is a plurality of people. Now, we move into the New Testament, and we see the teaching of the Trinity get even stronger. In Matthew chapter 3, we have the story of Jesus getting baptized. Jesus goes into the water where John the Baptist is. John the Baptist baptizes him. He comes up out of the water, up out of the river. And as he's doing that, we're told that a voice from heaven spoke and a dove descended down. And the voice from heaven said, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased," right? So in this one short section, this one quick story of Jesus' baptism, we see all three parts of the Trinity present at one time. We hear God the Father speaking to his son, Jesus, and the Spirit then descending upon him in the form of the dove. So right there, at that one moment, we see all three of them converge together and be present together at the same time. And later in Matthew 28, verse 19 and 20, our vision verse for as a church, Jesus gives the command to go and make disciples and to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, now we'll talk a little bit more about this in a moment, but let me just say this, that when he does that, he is indicating that there is equality among the three of them. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14, Paul is ending his book to the Corinthians, or his letter to the Corinthians, and he says this, "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Why else would Paul ask that those three entities be with the church if they were not all part of God? If they were not all God? Okay? He wouldn't. He wants them to have God present within them, among them. He wants the blessing of God to be upon them. And so when he states it that way, he again is given equality to all three of those persons. Okay? So, what we find is that even though the Bible does not use the word Trinity, from beginning to end, it teaches that there are three in one. Now again, we can't fully comprehend the depth and the scope of this. Our finite brains will only go so far. Mine goes even less than yours. Right? But what we can do is gain a deeper understanding, and we do that by understanding three simple statements about the Trinity. One is, God is three persons. Statement number one. Statement number two, each person is fully God. And statement number three, there is only one God. Okay, now, let's break these down individually. God is three persons. The Bible teaches that the Father, the Son, and the Spirit are three separate, distinct entities, persons, people. Okay? The Father is not the Son is not the Spirit is not the Father. Okay? They are each their own. In John 1, verse 1, we see how Jesus and God the Father are separated. John 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Okay, we know that Jesus is represented by the title of the Word, because he came to give us the Word about who God is. That's what the Gospels are about. So he is the Word. So when John writes here that he was with God and was God, what he's saying is Jesus is fully God and he was with God, so he couldn't be God the Father also. Right? Because if they were the same, he wouldn't have had to say he was with God, because you would know that God's only one person, so obviously whoever was there is God. So he separates them out and enables us to know that they are two distinct persons. They're both fully God. They both were together at the time of creation. It establishes their separateness. In 1 John chapter 2, John writes this, "Christ is our advocate, our high priest, going before the Father on our behalf." Okay? If Jesus and God the Father were the same, Jesus couldn't go before the Father. Right? Because he's the Father. There's only one if that's the case. Right? I can't go before myself. You can't go before yourself. Right? There's got to be two people. Jesus is coming before God on our behalf, therefore, he is separate from God the Father. They are distinct. They are individuals. They are persons. Otherwise, he would not be able to go before the Father on our behalf, because he would be the Father. He would just be God. So when John tells us that he goes before the Father on our behalf, he's saying these are two distinct, separate entities. And Jesus, one of Jesus' responsibilities is to go to the Father for us. Okay, so God the Father and God the Son are separate, but they are also then separate from the Spirit. In John 14, 26, Jesus teaches, tells the disciples that he is leaving, and when he does, that the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in his name, in Jesus' name. Okay? Now, this separates the Son and the Father from the Spirit because he can't come from them if he is them. Alright? If the Spirit is the same as the Son and God, then Jesus would say, hey, guess what? I'm Jesus the Son, but I'm also the Counselor. No one else is coming because I'm already here. Alright? And so when he says he is coming, he'll be sent. That indicates he's himself. He's a distinct person. Okay? And he'll be sent then as a distinct person. And so it shows the separateness, the separate persons of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. Okay? So they're each distinct persons. Second statement was each person is fully God. God the Father is God. Right? We saw that from Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created. Throughout the Bible, it is clear that there's this concept of God. Right? God speaks to Abraham. God calls a people. God goes through Moses. God anoints a king. God is there. He is the sovereign one. In the New Testament, Jesus prays to God the Father. The night of his betrayal, he's in the garden, and he's praying to God the Father, take this cup from me. Right? If he wasn't God, he wouldn't be praying to him like that. The paralytic is dropped through the ceiling where Jesus is teaching. And he looks at the paralytic and he says, get up, your sins are forgiven. And everybody in the room goes, ugh. And why do they do that? Because only God can forgive sins. So there's this concept of God throughout the Bible. There's a concept of God in our world, right? I mean, I want to thank the Academy, and first of all, I want to thank God, right? Everybody thanks God. Nobody thanks Jesus, but they all thank God, right? Because there's this understanding that there's something God-like, at least, out there. So we understand that God the Father is God. That's almost a given. The problems come when we associate Jesus as being God and the Spirit as being God. And yet, we find that they both are. Jesus is God. John 1:1 says that. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Okay? Not only is Jesus present there, but John says he's God. It reminds us of Genesis 1:1 and the creation account and the understanding that Jesus is God to the extent that he was before creation. Okay, when creation came about, in the beginning, Jesus already was. Jesus is. Jesus will be. He's got those same attributes as God. And so Jesus is God. Now, John 20 is a wonderful proof of Jesus being God. John 20 is after Christ has risen from the dead, the tomb is empty. You'll remember the disciples were all huddled up in their upper room, the doors locked, they're freaking out, wondering what in the world's going to happen to us. Where's this guy who we thought was the Messiah? And all of a sudden he appears in their presence, and they all recognize who he is, and they all believe now that what he said he would do, he's done, that he is the Messiah. And they're all there except Thomas. And so afterwards, they go and they run, they find Thomas, and they say, Thomas, it's true, Jesus is alive. And Thomas says, I won't believe it unless I see the nail scars and the wound in his side. A few days later, they're back in the upper room. Thomas is with them. Jesus once again appears, and he looks at Thomas. He says, Thomas, here you go. This is what you needed to see. And Thomas bows before God, or before Jesus, and he cries out, my Lord and my God. Now, the interesting thing about that is, Jesus doesn't correct him. If Jesus were not God, he'd say, oh, Thomas, such a good boy, thank you, but I'm not God. No, you've got it wrong. I'm just a really good guy. I had a really good doctor. He didn't say that, though, right? John writes about it, and John doesn't say, Thomas, yeah, he said that, but Thomas had a little drinking problem, and so he was a little off that day. They don't make any excuses for it. They don't correct it in any way because it was true. Now, take it to the next step, because then Jesus says, okay, Thomas, blessed are you because you saw and believed, but even more blessed are those who come after you, Thomas, who do not see and still believe. So not only did Jesus not correct Thomas, but he said that those who come after him are going to exclaim the same thing about me. And he did nothing to correct that thought either. In fact, he encouraged it. So when Thomas cries out and calls Jesus God, Jesus accepts that praise and that worship because he was God. And if he hadn't been, he would have said so. John would have written that part out. John would have put a little note in there that says, Jesus really isn't God. He was just being nice that day. But you don't find that because Jesus is God and he accepted the praise and the worship. Thirdly, then, the Spirit is God. Okay? In Matthew 28:19, our vision verse, I said we talked about this more in a minute. Jesus says that we're to baptize people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when he does that, he is giving equality among all of them. If those three are not equal, him saying we're to baptize in their names makes no sense. Jesus would not have said, nobody would have said, baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the angel Michael. Nobody would have elevated a human being to a point like that because that's not appropriate. Okay? So when Jesus said to baptize in those three names, he was equal, they were all equal in his sight. Meaning they were all God. And when we get baptized into God's name only. And so by elevating the Spirit along with God the Father and God the Son, Jesus is saying all three of these are God. And when you baptize into those three names, you're baptizing these folks into the family of God. Now, we see this even more in Acts chapter 5 with the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Okay, Ananias and Sapphira are part of the early church. And they see all these people selling their stuff, their goods, and giving this money to the church. And they want to be a part of it. And they've got land, so they go and they sell the land. They keep some of the money for themselves, which they had the right to do. It was their property. But they go to the church, and they give the money, and they claim that that's everything they got for it, the land. Okay? God taps Peter on the shoulder and says, no, they're lying. Peter goes to Ananias and said, why have you lied to the Holy Spirit? You have not lied to men, but to who? But to who? God. So in saying that, Peter is equating the Holy Spirit with God. Okay? He's saying you lied to the Holy Spirit, the same as lying to God, because they're the same. So we see that God the Father is God, Jesus is God, and the Spirit is God. Now, this final statement is an important statement because if we see them as three distinct individuals or persons and each of them are fully God, we might be tempted, and some are tempted, to say, okay, that's great, I get that. So you've got three gods. You've got God the Father, you've got God the Son, you've got God the Spirit. See, you've got three gods because they're all distinct and they're all God. So you've got three gods. Christianity is a polytheistic religion. Well, this is where the part comes in that we don't fully grasp, okay? Because we don't understand how they can be three distinct beings all fully God, yet be one God. But that's what Scripture teaches. And this is where we live by faith and not by sight. This is where we live by faith and not with, you know, the deepest, as deep a theological knowledge as you could possibly have. We live by faith. The Bible teaches that there's only one God. In Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 6, is the Shema. It is the saying that all good Jews were to recite daily. And it begins, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." So every day they would recite this, and so in their minds they understood God is one. In Isaiah 45, it says, "I am the Lord, there is no other. Besides me, there is no God." There's only one God. He's the Lord. That's it. No others. And Paul, in Romans 3:30, he said, "There's one God." He confirmed it in 1 Timothy 2:5, when he said, "There's one God." So the Bible teaches there's only one God. And so we can't get our minds necessarily fully around this idea, but we have to accept it by faith. That the Godhead is God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit, three distinct persons, each fully and always God, but there's only one God. Now, it might help us to have some kind of picture to put with this, or some kind of analogy that we can kind of help us understand, or help us explain it maybe a little bit. And so there's a couple I'm going to show you, but let me be perfectly clear that each of these has flaws, okay? Each of these can't possibly help us understand the concept of the Trinity completely because these are thought up by men, right? Nowhere, you won't find these in the Bible, okay? God did not inspire, well, he may have inspired us to come to this point with them, but God didn't, you know, develop these. And so they're going to have shortcomings, all right? But the first one is the egg. All right, you have one egg, but it has three distinct parts, right? It's got the shell, it's got the yolk, and it's got the white. Each of those are an egg, and each of those make up the whole egg, but the yolk is not the shell, and the shell is not the white, and all of those, right? So it breaks down, because the egg isn't, it's only part of the egg, right? The white's not the whole egg. The yolk's not the whole egg. Right? So there's problems there. But it might help you if you look to explain it to say, you know, it's like an egg, right? An egg's got three parts, a shell, the white, and the yolk. But it's still an egg. I don't know. Maybe it won't help you. But maybe it might. The next one I like, and it's H2O. What's H2O?
Water.
Water displays itself as a liquid, as a gas, and as a solid. Right? So when you have each of those three, you have it in a different form, but you still have H2O. Right? Now again, there's flaws with this because they aren't all the same thing all the time. You know, they can't all be the same thing. If you have steam and you have ice, you know, your ice is going to go bye-bye. And the Godhead is not like that. It doesn't fight each other or kill each other, you know, kind of thing. Whereas steam's going to melt ice and you don't have ice anymore. So it breaks down. But if you're talking or someone's asking about the Trinity, maybe this will help. Well, it's like H2O, okay? You have liquid, you have steam, you have ice, but they're all H2O, okay? So to a certain extent, it helps us to get our minds around it to a certain degree to help us understand it a little bit better. Now, why is it important to talk about this? I mean, again, we're talking about a word that's not even in the Bible. So what's the significance? What's the importance of the Trinity? Well, there's three things that are at risk if the Trinity is not true. The first is that the atonement is at stake. If Jesus isn't fully God, then his death on the cross meant nothing. Okay? If he's not able to take our punishment, able to take our sin upon him, then we're still in our sin. Okay? We have not been made at one with God. So the atonement is at risk. Secondly, justification by faith is at risk. Can Jesus, if he's not fully God, save us? No. If Jesus isn't fully God, can we depend on him for salvation? No. And so if we don't have him to depend on, then there's nothing to have faith in, and so in many ways, salvation can become a works-based thing, right? If we don't have a Savior, then we think, oh, well, hey, I better get to work then. My goods better start adding up, and my bads better start going down, so that when the big guy does look at me, he can say, oh, hey, you know, your good side's much better, so come on in. But that's not the way it works. So there's got to be somebody to take our place. And Jesus was that person, so he has to be fully God. But if the Trinity is not true, and he's not, then we're still headed south. Okay? And then finally, prayer and worship are at stake. Right? We pray in Jesus' name. But if he's not the Son of God, who cares? Right? What significance is there to praying in Jesus' name if he's not the Son of God? It really isn't. Jesus intercedes on our behalf, but he's not the Son of God. He's not in the presence of God. So how can he intercede for us? We often will pray to Jesus. So how, if he's not the Son of God, how can he possibly hear all of our prayers? How can he be everywhere at the same time? Do we have to go to one place and pray because that's where Jesus is today? And so our prayer life takes a big hit if Jesus isn't God, and therefore not the Trinity's not true. But in addition to that, our worship takes a big hit because we come here, we worship God, we worship Christ. But if he's not God, he's not worthy to be worshipped. Right? And the Spirit, if he's not fully God, then he's not able to usher us into the presence of God. He's not able to take us to the throne of grace. And so, there's really nothing then, or our worship is at stake because the Trinity is not true. Now, let me close with this thought. Basically, the Trinity boils down to this. Okay, if the Trinity is not true, Jesus was either a lunatic or a liar, but he wasn't Lord. Okay? And if he's not Lord, then he can't atone for us, he can't justify us, and he's not worthy to pray to or worship. And if the Trinity is not true, then we are destined for hell. And Paul's words in 1 Corinthians are even more true. We are to be pitied above all others. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the truth of who you are. That you are the three in one. The Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. And Lord, I pray that even though we can't fully get our minds around the whole concept, that that's a good thing because it means you are God and we're not. And we're thankful that we can live by faith until we get to see when we come to be with you. And so help us to live each day in that thought, that mindset, that understanding of who you are, that you are God, and there is no other like you. In your name we pray. Amen. We come to the table today, to the communion table that is open to all, to a place of faith and trust in Christ, and so we invite you to partake with us, if you so choose. This table, it represents a body broken and blood shed. That represents Jesus as the Son of God, willingly going to the cross so that we might have hope and have life. Because he is the only one who could and did do that. So let us pray together for the bread. Father God, we thank you for this bread that symbolizes a body broken for us. A body that was perfect. A body that was the Son of God. And in that bread, Lord, I pray that we would see your love, know your sacrifice, and be able to attest to the truth that you are who you say you are, and you've done what you said you've done. And that in that, you've given us a hope and a future. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us pray for the cup. Our Father God, we thank you for this cup that symbolizes your shed blood. Your blood that was shed because there was no one else worthy and no one else available or no one else with the ability to do it. And in that, Lord, you've washed us white as snow. You've covered us with your blood so that when God the Father looks at us, he sees you. Thank you for that. Remind us of that as we partake of it together. In Christ's name we pray. Thank you. Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks for it. And he said, this is the cup, my blood, a new covenant. Things are now different. For this is what saves. Let's drink. Praise team comes up, I invite you to stand as we close together in worship. We'll also be taking our deacon's fund offering, just asking you to give as the Lord might be.
Save the wretch like me.
not true, that grace isn't so amazing. So, Father, we come before you, recognizing that there is one God who reveals himself to us as our Father, as our Savior, and as our God. Might we live in such a way that pleases and honors him. Might we live out that amazing grace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit, we all pray.
Thank you. I mean, we could technically then get all the way back.
I'll just stand out in the offing and catch.
Yes.
Yep, see you later.
Hey, did you name all those?
The reason I'm saying that is just remember.
Yeah,
Nick's been taking care of that.
Okay.